Great. So first of all, thank you for inviting me to be here. It's always a pleasure to be in New Zealand, and it looks like it's not pouring so bad right now, so it's maybe there will be some time to walk around. In any case, I wanted to talk about the Pegasus workflow management system and our experience of extending it to the edge. So we've been working on Pegasus since 2001 was the first kind of incarnation of a system. And basically, it allows you to automate complex multi-stage processing pipelines. So you have a number of tasks that are operating on data. Typically, these are files. They produce other files, and you have that whole recipe that allows you to put together a complex application. It also, within these various tasks, you can have tasks that are parallel. So you can have your OpenMP computation. You can have more distributed type of view of a computation, so individual tasks, but maybe spread out over a number of different resources. And then Pegasus automatically executes this recipe. It maps it onto the resources that are available to the user. It also does data transfer. So if you're running things across different resources, it will automatically move the data for you. It is reusable in its concept, so you can share your workflows with others. The workflows are not tied to particular resources, so you can share it with your colleague and they can run it on their own infrastructure. And so we believe that that aids in reproducibility. As we execute the workflow, scientists oftentimes want to see how the results were actually produced, so we need to keep a record of the provenance of the results. So we record all the steps that are taking place, the different parameters that are used during the computations, the resources that things ran on. And then, obviously, things go wrong, so we have a number of failure mechanisms that we provide to recover from them. And in cases we cannot recover, then we provide the user with debugging capabilities to help pinpoint the sources of errors. And throughout it all, we also track files that contain the data so that we can do various optimization based on where the data is located. So traditionally, we've been looking at supporting applications in various domains. We started working with LIGO, which is a gravitational wave experiment in the US, which has two different installations. One in Washington State and one in Louisiana. And we started working with them about 2001 and trying to figure out what type of capabilities they needed to support their complex pipelines. In 2016, they announced the first ever direct detection of a gravitational wave. And to look kind of behind that type of detection, it took them about 6 months to confirm that what we were seeing in the instruments was actually a gravitational wave and not noise. If you look at what they had to do, they had to run about 21,000 workflows. All of them contained about 107 million tasks. So they had the scientific workflow that they described the various analysis that they needed to do. They used Pegasus as a middleware to map the scientific workflows onto the cyber infrastructure that was available to them. In particular, they have their own clusters. They also used the Open Science Grid in the US, which is a high-throughput computing platform. They also used HPC platforms of Exceed and Blue Waters. So other applications that we've been supporting over the years, and again, these applications drive the development of our software. So this application is from USC. This is the Southern California's Earthquake Center CyberShake application. This application generates seismic hazard maps of Southern California, and also they went up to look at the Northern California region as well. This is an interesting application because they first started out with large-scale MPI parallel simulations, which are followed then by post-processing. And so the simulations, we basically can count them on one hand, the number of jobs that they represent in the workflow. However, they have thousands and thousands of post-processing that needs to happen. Sometimes they run them on high-performance computing resources, and this is primarily because they need access to the data that's being generated by the simulation, so they don't want to do the data transfer. However, these post-processing jobs can also easily be orchestrated on high-throughput computing resources, and then Pegasus can manage also that transfer of data from the HPC systems to the discrete resources that execute the post-processing. Other applications that we've been working with are a little bit different in the sense that, yes, they do simulation. So this is from the Event Horizon Telescope. The scientists from EHT collect the data, and they generate these beautiful pictures of black holes, but they really don't understand all the physics and meaning behind them unless they do the simulations, and they try matching what we see through the simulation with what is observed through the telescope. So they use Pegasus to do these simulations to be able to understand their data. What's interesting for us in this particular application is that they use a system called Cybers to do the data management. So in this particular case, the Pegasus workflow management system has to also work with cyber infrastructure that's specific. Although it's a generic, Cybers is pretty generic, we need to work with this infrastructure that's being used by the scientists to do the work. Other applications that also have specific data management requirements is the Xenon NT project, which is a dark matter search project. In this case, they come from the high-energy physics, and they use Rusio for data management, and they also use MongoDB to manage the metadata. So all these systems, data system influence how the workflow management system is designed, so it can interface with them and then automate as much as possible the analysis that's being conducted by the scientists in these various domains. So as you can see, traditionally, we've been focusing on applications that run on high-performance computing systems and applications that run on high-throughput computing systems. Recently, we've also started looking at putting an instrument in the loop. So at USC, the university has bought two cryo-EM machines, and they're trying to figure out how to deliver data to the users in a way that they can adjust the experiment when the experiment is running. So you need to have some kind of initial processing of the data being examined under the microscope, and it has to be fast enough that it gives a feedback to the user why they're still conducting the experiment. So in this case, the data is coming off the experiment, it's being moved to the USC HPC facility, and from there it's being picked up by the workflow management system, and it's being processed on the fly to provide very simple processing and view of what's going on with the application. And then it also sends out the notifications and images via Slack to the users so they can see whether they're looking at the right part of a sample or they need to adjust maybe some parameters of this experiment. So we've looked at, so far I have not talked much about the edge, but now we see applications coming from that domain. So we see various applications that can benefit from edge computing, where you want to do some processing close to where the data was collected, and you don't have a HPC system, such as in the case of a cryo-EM facility. So some of the applications that we've been working with, one comes from the biology domain. So there was a nice paper by the scientists in Switzerland looking at zooplankton in a Swiss lake. And so we want to ask the question, and the paper was nice not only from the scientific point of view, but they also make the data, the models available so that you can reproduce the results. And in fact, we had students within my group, undergraduate students, reproduce the results for the lakes in near Geneva. And the question is now, can we take these capabilities and look at data coming from lakes in the US and see how we need to adjust maybe the machine learning algorithms to do the zooplankton identification automatically as the camera is capturing the data from the lake? So this is a question we posed. It turns out that the machine learning models need to be adjusted, but that's the type of applications that we want to be able to support with Pegasus. Another application that we're working with is from University of Massachusetts at Amherst. It's called CASA, Collaborative and Adaptive Sensing of the Atmosphere. So in this case, the scientists have deployed near short-range Doppler radars in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. So you have a lot of weather usually coming through this area. You have a large population center, so you want to be able to have early warning systems that look at the wind, the precipitation coming into the area, and warn, for example, hospitals and others that a severe event is coming up. So normally you do some processing of the data close to the radars, but as the severity of the weather increases, you want to be able to send some of this processing to the cloud to be able to provide the predictions more efficiently. And then the final applications that application we've been looking at comes from the Ocean Observatory Initiative. And this is a large facility within the US. They have deployed a number of sensors throughout the Pacific and also, I believe, in the Atlantic as well. And they have some of these sensors are hydrophones that you can use to listen to orca sounds. So they develop machine learning models to recognize orca sounds as they're being picked up in the ocean. So if you look at the execution environments that Pegasus has supported over the years, we started 2001, grids were popular. In 2003, we started supporting HPC clusters, particularly because of the Southern California Earthquake Center. In 2005, we did work on improving support for HCC systems. So back then, you didn't have tons of storage available at the clusters. So, and the workflows were quite big. So we looked at optimizing the data footprint to support these applications. In 2008, we started exploring the use of clouds for scientific computing, in particular looking at issues of cost, how much would it cost to run a montage workflow, for example, that you see the results of on the right, on the cloud, and how scientists could optimize the execution of these workflows, not only for performance, but also cost. Then recently in 2021-22, we started putting the instruments in the loop and seeing how we can optimize the experimental side of things, so how scientists can use workflows in real time to do the work. And so the question we posed ourselves, we see these new applications coming up that can benefit from edge computing. Can we extend Pegasus to the edge? So far, you know, up to recently, we had five principles that Pegasus operated under, and so we wanted to see if these principles would carry us forward. So let me talk a little bit about the principles that we've developed over the years and really held us through these different infrastructures. So one is a resource-independent specification of a workflow. So the scientist basically describes the workflow in terms of logical components, so logical transformations and logical files. So it can say, I want to do an FFT on file A, and then there is a catalog that maps this particular, this logical information to the physical location. So FFT could be a particular FFT code at a particular location, or a file name could be a file that's replicated in a number of different storage systems. So the scientist gives that high-level description to Pegasus. Pegasus also has what we call a side catalog that tells you how a computational environment looks like. And this is something that a scientist can create or they pull from information service. And then Pegasus generates a concrete workflow, so that's an executable workflow that you see on the right. In this workflow, it adds nodes to create directories where the workflow is going to run on the remote side. It will stage in data if necessary. It will have actual command lines to submit jobs to a particular HPC system or to a condo pool or to the cloud. It will also have data movement jobs within. So if you run your workflow across two different infrastructures, it will add these jobs to the workflow at this point. It will also stage out the results to where the user wanted to go. And it will register the results in a catalog. So for example, in case of EHT, it will put back the results into Cyverse so that scientists can find them there. And we also do some other, during the process, we also do various optimization for performance, reliability, and data footprint. So the other principle that we have is this submit locally, run globally. So the workflow management system is deployed within a submit host, which is within the control of a user or a community. Within that submit host, we have the Pegasus planner that does this transformation from the abstract to executable workflow. We also use HT Condor Dagman to manage the execution of the concrete workflow, executable workflow that we created. And then we also use HT Condor underneath Dagman to manage the execution of individual tasks on the distributed resources. And so this layered approach has worked, again, well for us throughout the years because we have our team focuses primarily on the mapping portion and the orchestration of a workflow, doing optimizations. And then in collaboration with Miron Livni and his Condor team, they work on the Dagman parts and HT Condor to improve these as we go along. So the other thing that, so this is, as I mentioned, the submit host is something under the control of a user. And then we have a model of an execution environment where we can have multiple compute sites and we can have the storage systems not being co-located with the compute. So they can be, but logically we can decouple them. And in particular, we can think of having an input data site, a staging data site, and output data site. So these are logical type of separations of storage, which allows us to then model different types of systems. So if you think of running on an HPC system, you'll collocate the storage within the HPC resource. If you're thinking of running an AWS, then you can think of a system as being a compute site and an object store. So you can use this high-level model to basically compose logically various types of systems that Pegasus recognizes. And for the user, this is, the user just needs to be able to say which type of system it is and not in that great level of detail, but for us from the execution, from the workflow planning side, that's how we think about the resources. So the third component is the flexible data staging configuration. So now you have these various storage systems and compute systems being in different locations. You can you can have collocation of storage, so Pegasus has to support various types of I/O. So we can run easily on Condor pools via Condor I/O, or we can run using the shared file system if the jobs land on a HPC resource. And we also support non-shared file systems that allow us to run in places where basically you land somewhere and you bring in the data before you run the job. So we can run on the Open Science Grid and others. Then the other thing that goes along with that, so now you have different storage configurations, but you also need to be able to move data between these various storage systems. So it's not only the job accessing it, but now Pegasus needs to add these jobs to the workflow to move things around. So it has, first we started supporting these various protocols that you see on the right, but then finally we started encapsulating into everything into a tool that we call Pegasus Transfer. So it can create and remove directories, it removes files, obviously. It can do two-state data transfers between incompatible storage systems. It can do parallel transfers, automatic retries of the data is replicated, you can pull out the next replica in case of failures, and it manages credentials. And then the fifth principle that we have is we have this up and down integration with diverse cyber infrastructure. So the users can write their abstract workflows using Python, Java. At some point, we're very excited about supporting R, where bio people were using it, but then everybody went to Python and Jupyter notebooks. But if you're still using R, you can run Pegasus workflows with it. And then, obviously, a lot of scientists don't use workflows directly. They use science gateways to do their computation. So we have integrations, as I mentioned, with Cybers, but also Hub Zero, where you can, when you're launching jobs through Hub Zero, you're actually launching workflows, Pegasus workflows underneath. Recently, we're also doing an integration with On Demand as part of a NSF-funded access project that aims at democratizing access to cyber infrastructure in the US. So on the bottom, you can see all the types of infrastructures that we integrate with. So we could basically schedule jobs onto campus clusters, your own local machine, the open science grid, and access. And we also can run on cloud resources as well. So with these five principles, we ask ourselves a question, would this work at the edge? So can we take Pegasus as it was designed for 20 years, and can we make it work with edge devices? And so the way we extended it, we decided to rely on Condor, so basically put Condor at the edge and use the matchmaking algorithms within Condor to match jobs that are slated to go to the edge to the edge resources. So the only thing that we needed to do is to add to Pegasus the ability to create Condor class ads that would specifically call out these edge resources during the matching process. So now the way we looked at the problem, now the edge device is basically another site in our catalog. It's another type of computing infrastructure, and then in this case, it accesses object storage, but you can also use different types of data management to configure those. So you can also directly stage data to an edge device if you want to. So we started doing various experiments around it, trying to figure out, okay, can we put these Pegasus at the edge using, you know, small Raspberry Pis, for example? Can we run workflows across these small devices? And in particular, we use the Chameleon edge computing testbed that has these devices plugged into and available to the users. So if you don't know, Chameleon is a cloud, general cloud testbed in the US, but if you're a researcher outside the US, from New Zealand, for example, you can access these resources as well, and they support all sorts of computer science research. So in this case, we basically created containers that we stuck HD Condor in. We put them on these small edge devices, and we ran just a very simple experiment. This is not earth-shattering, but basically we want to see, can we create a little Condor pool across them and then run jobs on these small devices? And in this case, we submitted some jobs to the queue, and we said, okay, if there are more jobs past a certain threshold than the number of idle workers or machines ready to run, then provision some more. And so, and then if the workers have nothing to do, then deprovision them after a certain amount of time. So basically, we ran these experiments, and it's really not to see, you know, how well the scaling algorithm does. It's really, can we really dynamically adjust this pool across the devices? And having this foundation, then we can think of, okay, what kind of applications we can run in these type of environments. So we wanted to see, in this case, we scaled up, so we decided, okay, the small device, it's great to have a proof of concept, but if you want to run some applications at the edge, there might not be enough resources at these devices to support the various computing we want to do. So we emulated the environment of a cloud and edge, and tried to start asking questions, how much computing you would want to do at the edge, how much you would want to do on the cloud. In this case, again, we used Chameleon for this purpose. So we had a TAC in Austin, Texas, at the University of Austin, Texas, Supercomputing Center. We set up our cloud infrastructure using that part of Chameleon that's deployed there. We also put our submit host in that environment, and we put some workers that were our cloud resources. Then across the network in Chicago, we use that part of the Chameleon to mimic edge devices that have data that's coming to them. So we had a repository set up with where the data is. So you can think of, for example, the CASA radars. They can send the data to a repository that's close, that's set up in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and have the edge devices pull out the data and do the computations. So in this case, again, this is not overshadowing, but we wanted to see the mechanics of supporting edge-to-cloud workflows. So we looked at just running things only at the edge, running the things that and at the edge, so the entire workflow ran there, the data was there, and so it was totally done without any use of a cloud. Then the edge-to-cloud, then you had part of the workflows executed at the edge, and the rest was being done on the cloud, and then cloud only, in this case, you have to pull the data from that, from the edge, from where it's stored close to the edge, to the cloud. And again, so this is looking basically, can a workflow management system support these various types of orchestrations, which we expect the scientists to want to be able to use in the work. So in this case, we basically looked at various workflows. We had a synthetic workflow that we designed that basically is has a lot of data that flows through it. So it's highlights the data movement part of edge to cloud workflows. We had the Casa Weaver workflow that I mentioned to you earlier, and the OrcaSound workflow. In the synthetic edge, we basically, this is quite a small workflow that has three levels, and it basically runs synthetic codes to do to simulate a workflow execution. But you can expect that a lot of workflows would have that structure that you collect some data at the edge devices, you compute there, and then at some point you move things to the cloud for synthesis, for example. So this could be also good in a case, so if you do federated learning, that might be that type of scenario. And in our work, we ran the first part, in some of the experiments, the first part on the edge. The Casa Wind workflow, this is a real application that's in deployment in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And there, we basically decided, okay, we'll see if we can put that first portion at the edge, which is being done today, but not with. But here we're trying to see if the Pegasus at the edge would support this capability, and then burst the rest to the cloud. And then the final workflow is the OrcaSound workflow that again has this nice decomposition. You can do some of the computations at the edge and then the rest on the cloud. So the evaluation, again, you know, you don't have to look closely at the numbers, but basically we wanted to see, can you do experiment running these synthetic Casa Wind and OrcaSound workflows? If you run them on top, you have a relative make span at the 100% being just run everything at the edge. And then you can see, in the case of a synthetic workflow, because it's very data heavy, it basically doesn't pay you to put this on the cloud and compute there. However, in terms of OrcaSound workflow, it seems to be beneficial. And for the Casa Wind, you have it's also beneficial, but you can also get better benefits, good benefits from just doing edge and cloud together. So then, in conclusion, basically, so I think we have a proof of concept that we can orchestrate things kind of in a similar way as we've been doing for HPC, high-throughput computing systems, looking towards the edge and seeing, and we think we see that the five principles that we developed over the years, that of resource-independent workflow description, this ability to think of submitting locally but running globally, various flexible data management configurations and data movements, and up and down integration with a diverse CI also translate to this edge environment, and you can bring in now the edge into the bigger fold of cloud computing resources, HPC resources. You can think of instruments in the loop as well. So you have kind of a family of resources that are now you now can bring together to solve your scientific workflow problems. What we want to do, however, is we want to test it and really see, you know, how far we can push this. Are there things that we do need to do with Pegasus as we see more different applications that do we need to do to support them? So I am looking forward to exploring more of these edge and edge to cloud workflows and trying to collect them from the community. So if you're interested in exploring that with us, we'll be very interested. We also make our workflows available. So if you want to test them out, you can do that. We want to also be able to look at various scheduling heuristics. So you can plug in schedulers within Pegasus, and we want to be able to see how we can adjust the scheduling or what scheduling algorithms we can put into the mix to take into account the amount of memory available on devices, the amount of power and others. And then, with people in this room, so with Ivana, we've been already talking about federated learning and how we can explore how much of the learning you put at the edge versus how much you put on the cloud and various other types of scenarios. So I'm looking forward to our continuing discussions. And with Pete, we've been talking about seeing how we can, is this type of technology applicable for production use? And so we started the discussion, and we look forward to having more of these discussions here. So thank you very much. And I hope we have more discussions coming our way. Thank you.